Good morning. Lovely to see you all this morning in the house of the Lord. It's good to be here, isn't it?
Hallelujah.
And to be in each other's company. For those of you who haven't been worshiping with us for a while, it's good to see you. I'm just looking around trying to spot who's behind the masks, but we can spot Annie anyway. But it is good. It's good to see you all. And you're most welcome in worship. Just a couple of announcements in relation to our activity this morning. Would like to thank John and Iris for the lovely arrangement of flowers at our holiness table this morning. Also, just a reminder that tea and coffee will be provided at the end of the service. We're going to exit by this door. There'll be nobody coming down to tell you when to move. We're trying to move away from that now, and just ask that you exit in an orderly fashion. Give each other some space as you leave the building, and refreshments will be served outside. I suppose it's worth just mentioning to you, we've been very fortunate at this stage with the weather. But obviously, as we're getting nearer the end of the year, there's no telling what the weather will do. And so we will need to be looking at what we do in terms of refreshments when the weather turns inclement. Please bear with us. We'll keep you posted on that as to how we will manage that, because we'd like to keep doing it, if at all possible. And we'll keep you in the loop with that, but just bear with us as we do. Also, just a reminder for those of you that are attending and those who may be looking to the future, Ignite is commencing again this evening, 6:30 at Belfast Sydenham Core. In terms of next Sunday, you'll all be aware that the Belfast Marathon is being held and the core building here is on the route, and therefore the road's access to the building will be closed until 11:30, but we will still be holding our service here at its normal time. That will mean that you will probably not get into the car park here, or you will not be able to park on the main road. You'll have to park in some of the side streets and work your way here. We understand that that's a bit of an inconvenience for most of us, but if we can work with that for 1 week in the year, we'll look to what we do next time when the marathon comes around. I think that's everything for now. You should have received your news sheet. If you haven't, there are some in the foyer. Please make sure that you get one, take it away with you, keep you up to date with all the announcements and all the things that are happening in the division over this next month. God bless you as you share in worship with us.
Good morning. I just want to also give another quick update regarding the streaming. So for people who are watching at home, that will be particularly important to you. We've been having some problems with the internet connection at the hall on a Sunday. Now, during the week, I do a test and the streaming works beautifully. No jumping, no nothing. And then when we go out live on a Sunday, it's a much slower stream. So we're working on that. We're trying to adjust it. So we do apologise that the quality's been bad the last couple of weeks. But it's not to do with things that we're doing here. It's to do with whoever our internet provider is and the quality of the stream that we're getting. So I apologise to those at home for that. We're working on it and we're going to try and get that sorted in the next couple of weeks. Also, I suppose I better just stand up here and be embarrassed in front of you all and say, I'm sorry if I haven't come to say hello to you this morning. I've actually sprained my ankle. So I'm limping around. I'm feeling my 50 years now, and it's very silly, but I've got a very swollen ankle, and so I can't walk around on it very much. Probably shouldn't be here, but I can stand on my other foot, and I'm fine here. So I'm glad to be with you. I apologise if I haven't come up to say hello personally, but I'm fine. Lisa's now going to introduce our worship. Thank you.
It's quite humorous, really, that we're talking about mountains today, and Chris sprained his ankle climbing a mountain yesterday. So there's a chuckle in our cheeks as we talk about that. It's not that we don't have sympathy for him. It's just a bit of a bit of chuckle. We come to worship God this morning. Do you realize that? It's great to have you here this morning. But the main reason we're here is to worship God. He is the center, he is our rock. The Psalms are full of praise to him. God is our rock, our salvation, our redeemer, our stronghold. He's the one who deserves our worship this morning, and we come willingly, wholeheartedly, and it's great to welcome you into God's presence this morning as we worship. We're going to sing together, Song 49, if you are using your songbooks. How great thou art. I don't know about you, but over this past week, again and again and again, everything around me reminds me of God, how great you are. And so this morning, as we lift our worship to God, I invite you to do that. Bring to God all the things that have turned your eyes to him through this past week. Bring that to him. Bring yourself as you are this morning and as you come. Let's stand together. Thank you, Lawrence.
Thank you.
Hallelujah. Take your seats. What a great sound we were able to make even behind our masks. Hallelujah. Great to have singing all over this morning and to hear those voices lifting up to the Lord. How great you are. Let's honor God in our prayer just now. Pray with me. Lord Jesus, we thank you for who you are. We worship you this morning. We have done already in our singing, honoring your name as our creator, as the one who is behind everything that we see, as the one who gave his life for us, and as the one who assures us of a home beyond what there is here. Lord, we thank you for the hope that we have in you, a hope that is for now, but also a hope that is for the future. Lord, thank you that you never change. Thank you that you are our rock, our redeemer, our savior, our refuge. Lord, we thank you that we can be here this morning. And we want to honor you in all that happens, Lord, in our singing, in our playing, in our listening, in our speaking, in our tea and coffee afterwards. Lord, we want to honor your name. Come and be our guest, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Thank you. We wanted to play a little game with you this morning. And so Ruben's going to watch me so he doesn't reveal the answers. We're going to play a little guessing game. We're going to put some pictures on the screen of different famous mountains. I'm going to see whether you can guess which mountain it is. Okay, so can everyone see the screen? So here's the first one. There's eight of them. Here's the first one. Which mountain is this? K2 or Everest is what I'm hearing. It's Everest. Sorry. good try though. Good try. Next one. Yeah, wrong side of it. What's this one? Table Mountain? Someone said Fuji? Kilimanjaro. Okay, here's this one. I'm hearing Fuji this time. Yeah? I think Andrew knows. Yeah, Andrew's got this. Fuji, Mount Fuji. Next one. Table Mountain. Yes. Let's have a look. Is it? Mm-hmm. Yes. Yes. And what's this one? Eiger? I'm hearing Eiger. Everybody else hasn't got a clue. Bit of a giveaway on the characteristics of this one. Rushmore. It is Rushmore, yes. And it is a mountain, yes. And this one. What did you say?
It's got a different name.
Oh, it's got different names. The name I know it by is Ayers Rock. Okay, and I think this is the last one, I think. Yes, Sugarloaf Mountain. Like, I've no idea why it's called that, is it? Because it looks like a sugarloaf, maybe, I don't know. Sugarloaf Mountain. Mountains are fantastic, and over the next few weeks, we kind of wanted to take a bit of a theme that will take us through a different way of scripture. And we're looking at some glorious mountain views. You can't really see very clearly on the screen there, I apologise, but you can get a picture of this at some point. We can give them out to you. Well, the next few weeks, we're going to be looking at mountains in scripture. There are many mountains in scripture, and mountains are often places where God gives people a new perspective, a new way of seeing something or themselves or his mercy or his grace. Just think of the different mountains you can think of in Bible stories. There was a sermon on a mount, wasn't there? Yes, there was the Mount of Transfiguration. Where did Noah's Ark end up? On a mountain. Yes, we're not actually doing that one, but we're going to be looking through various mountains over the next few weeks and considering some great mountain views. And this week we thought that we would have a little bit of a question of a family who we know love going up mountains. And they're sitting behind me here. And so we asked them, this is really sort of Liesl and myself really saying, this got me thinking, mountains got us thinking this week. That's what's so ridiculous that I sprained my ankle coming down a mountain yesterday. In fact, it was halfway down the brandy pad, so that's where I was, and I had to walk down the rest of it on a sprained ankle. Yes, it was. I took it very, very slowly, and it's now very, very swollen. But I know, that's okay, we'll be fine. But some people who actually know how to do it properly are the Murrays, and we're going to invite them to come and talk to us about some of their experiences of mountains. We've asked them to just to show us some pictures. So I'm going to ask them to come to the platform here. And Reuben, if you could just forward. Thank you.
Come on.
There we are. Thank you.
So hopefully these are in order. And I was nominated to be the only person to talk. So apologies in advance. Could I have the first slide, please?
I've got them together.
Okay, right. Well, this is fine. Yeah. So I actually started off my love of the mountains on a singing company trip. And I wasn't actually in the singing company, but I was asked to come along to help out. And I was actually down at the little outdoor pursuit centre that used to be down at Analong, Winlands, as Tom and Audrey will know about. And during the Saturday, I think it was, we all decided to go on a little walk up from, and please excuse me for saying this, but the Bloody Bridge car park. And, you know, we took a walk up around that area, and the mountains were looking absolutely fantastic. I think it was in February, and there was snow on top of them, and they just looked so fantastic and were a marvel of creation. And it just enticed me, because I actually had a bit of a fear of heights, and I thought, well, this is a bit of a challenge. I want to go back here. And also was taking an interest in photography at the time, and that sort of got me going. And then at Queen's, me and a friend called Eamon, we used to go up the Mournes every Saturday and used to have great fun together. And again, we were attracted by the beauty of creation, and I would have taken a few photographs and what have you. And then later on, when Cheryl accosted me, then I kind of introduced her to mountaineering, and I think the first trip we had was going up to the top of Slieve Binion, and constantly all I heard was, are we there yet? Are we there yet? So it was like being back in primary school. So as you can see that we enjoyed many times up the Mournes in the top left-hand corner. We would have camped up quite regularly up at Loch Shannon, etc. And then that kind of led us to go further afield. And these other photographs are some of the trips that we had to Switzerland. As you can see, we're quite high up in the right-hand one. And then the one at the bottom is actually taken when we were on top of a glacier. Now, I don't know whether anybody's ever walked across a glacier before, but it can be quite frightening, you know, apart from the fact that you might be walking over a snow-covered crevasse, and you can hear the thing creaking underneath you. So, well, it was either the glacier creaking or Cheryl creaking, one of the two. I think it was the glacier, but it kind of makes you have to pray a lot, because you don't want anything to move underneath you that shouldn't be. And also at the time, I developed quite a friendship with Paul McCulloch, whom I know a lot of you will have known, who sadly, very sadly passed away earlier this year. And Paul also had a great love of photography. And we used to go down to the Mournes regularly, and we used to camp up in all sorts of places, including the top of Slieve Birna once. And we got up at 4 o'clock in the morning to take photographs of the sunrise, and it was an absolutely fabulous experience. It blew the head off you, but it was great. So can I have the next group of slides? So again, these are some pictures of our trips to Switzerland. And the top left-hand corner is a place called Concordia Plaza, which is up at the Jungfrau. Then on the right-hand side is a picture of sunrise on the north face of the Eire, which was actually mentioned earlier on. I remember that very distinctly. I got up very early in the morning to go out and take this photograph. And it was just such a marvellous feeling. It really made you feel really joyful for creation, etc. And it was such a wonderful feeling walking back into the village of Mourne when the locals were starting to get up and you could smell the bread baking, being freshly baked. It was such a wonderful experience. And then the bottom photograph is again a photograph of the Eire and the monk, again at the other end of the day, the sunset. So it's fabulous that you can enjoy mountains at any time of the day, and they're always there. They change very, very, very little, but they're always there to be enjoyed. So could I have the next slides, please? Yes. So also it was a chance for us to show some fashion statements as well. As you can see on the top left-hand corner, this must have been this obviously was the fashion of the 1980s, and on the top right-hand side, you'll see Cheryl sporting a perm, which again was a good feature. And the bottom one, you can't actually see the whole of the photograph, which is probably very fortunate. And can I just add that this was actually before the days when pole dancing started, so this was just me. Actually, this is a photograph. I'm holding on to a sign for mountain paths, which have Edelboden and Lenk on it. And ironically, Edelboden is one of the places that the youth band was meant to be going to in the April, just after lockdown happened. So it was quite nice to see that again. Could I have the next slide, please? So bringing forward to latter days when the girls arrived, I wouldn't say they took a fantastic interest in going up mountains initially, but certainly they had their fair share of it. And on the top left-hand side, that's us on top of a mountain just outside Enniskillen called Topped Mountain. And that's the four girls having reached the top, some a bit more reluctantly than others, not mentioning names, Amy. But sometimes it can be a real slog to get up a mountain. Actually worse when you're going down it, and actually a lot of accidents. Going down, because you know, you think it's a struggle going up, but you tend to be less careful coming down. And I think there's a story in that for all of us, that it's not just a matter of reaching the mountain top. You might get there, and even in a Christian experience, you might get to the top of the mountain in your experience, but you have to be careful on the way back down again, that you don't lose your way and you miss a foot space, and you go over and you're kind of either lost or damaged, so you need to be actually more careful going down. And then on the right hand side is Bethany and Rebecca, just after I think I told them on the Trassic track that we were going to go to the top of that mountain in the background, so they look absolutely thrilled, don't you? Yeah. So can I have the next slides, please? So again, I think there's been quite a resurgence of interest in mountain walking, particularly since lockdown occurred and people were sitting about thinking what to do. Oh, I'll clear the house out, I'll fix the garden. Oh, I'll take up mountain walking or cycling again, etc. So there's quite a resurgence of that since lockdown, and that certainly happened to us as well. We kind of renewed our interest in it. And this is a picture of us just earlier on this year with Cheryl and Rebecca and Amy and her boyfriend, Lewis, who had come over from Wales. So again, beautiful, sunny, rich day, which just makes you feel so grateful for all of creation and what God has given to us. So can I have the next slide, please? Yeah, this is a walk down in outside Enniskillen. Does anybody know where this is? No, it's actually called the Stairway to Heaven. Yeah, and it's a boardwalk at Culca Mountain, just outside Enniskillen. And you know, for someone who doesn't fancy walking over rough ground, there's actually a boardwalk that takes you up to the foot of this mountain on the right-hand side, and then there's a set of steps which take you to the top, hence the name Stairway to Heaven. And I think for many of us, that's what it's like being in the mountains. It's like a stairway to heaven, really, and it brings you just closer to God, and you just marvel at creation and what's been done for us. Also over lockdown, for instance, on Easter Sunday morning, a group of us went up at Divis Mountain to see the sunrise over Belfast, which again was a marvellous experience. I don't know a lot of other people do that as well. Also, despite displaying my complete ignorance of Everest earlier on, we've actually been to Everest. So I think this might be in the next slide, hopefully. Yes. Unfortunately, it wasn't in Nepal. It was just the Disney ride in Florida. But but we've been to Everest. And on the right-hand side, again, this was earlier on this year when Cheryl and I decided to walk to the top of Slieve Croob just early on a Sunday morning to see the sunrise, and this is what we saw. And again, I remember Cheryl just being so grateful, and just it kind of makes you marvel at the works of God, etc. And that's the sort of feeling it gives to us. Plus, it's good exercise and everything as well. Could I have the next slide, please? Yeah. I mean, for many people, going up a mountain just isn't feasible. It just isn't possible. Maybe in your earlier days, etc., and you just can't do it. But it doesn't stop you looking at mountains and enjoying their beauty from afar. And this was a photograph just taken during the summer when we went down to Enniskillen for a short break, and we drove across to Bundoran. And this is actually a photograph taken at Bundoran to see the sunset. So again, you don't have to climb up mountains to enjoy their beauty, etc. You can see them from afar and enjoy them just as they are. Could I have the last slide? I think it's the last slide. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So this is actually a prayer that is found at the top of the Schilthorn, which is a mountain just at Mourne in Switzerland, and we actually climbed up it. And it's entitled the Wawi Oculus. Bethany assures me that's the pronunciation of it. And that roughly translates as I lift up my eyes. And it was written by a person called Arnold Lunn, who I believe was actually the son of a Methodist minister, but he was an agnostic. But he challenged some of his friends to have a debate about Christianity. And it was as a result of that debate, he actually converted to Christianity. And this, he was a mountaineer, a British mountaineer and skier. And this is just a verse that he wrote. And I think this probably sums up better than what I could say what it means to be, whether you're looking at mountains or you're climbing mountains. I think this just really sums it up. And it reads, "Let me give thanks, dear Lord, in the frailty of age, for the beloved mountains of my youth, for the challenge of rock, and for the joy of skiing, for the friends with whom I climbed and skied, and above all, dear Lord, for those moments of revelation when the temporal beauty of the mountains reinforces my faith in the eternal beauty which is not subject to decay." Thank you.
Amen. Amen. Thank you so much for, I mean, that could sum up the whole of the series between now and the end of November. We're very grateful to you and for sharing those beautiful pictures and your passion. We're very, very grateful. Let's stand together, just for a moment, if you're able. If you're welcome to stay seated if you want to, but just to use that Psalm 121 together, and as we just share and reflect in this prayer together, we've asked Lawrence to play through the mountains of Mourne. So let's stand, and the words will come up now on the screen. My help come from. slide, please. My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let your foot slip. He who watches over you will not slumber. Indeed, he who watches over Israel will neither slumber nor sleep. The Lord watches over you. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not harm you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and going, both now and forevermore. This morning, Lord, we thank you because you are a God who is greater than the mountains. You are a God who spoke and those mountains came into being. You are a God who speaks into our hearts and our lives, and that your beauty is just briefly glimpsed when we get those moments of sheer joy. We thank you this day that you are here with us. You are not far away. You are not difficult to access. You are very close. You are with us and you love us. So thank you, Lord. Thank you for all that you do. Thank you that you're always there, secure, and you enable us as we live through our lives to feel safe and secure every step of the way. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Lisa's going to bring our Bible reading to us now. Thank you.
I'm reading from Genesis 22, 1 to 18. You will have seen, possibly as you came in and you picked up your news sheet, that we're looking at the mountain of Moriah today. And this is where we find the account in Genesis chapter 22. Thank you, Reuben. Sometime later, God tested Abraham. He said to him, "Abraham." "Here I am," he replied. God said, "Take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains I will tell you about." Early the next morning, Abraham got up and saddled his donkey. He took with him two of his servants and his son Isaac. When he had cut enough wood for the burnt offering, he set out for the place God had told him about. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw the place in the distance. He said to his servants, "Stay here with the donkey while I and the boy go over there. We will worship, and then we will come back to you." Abraham took the wood for the burnt offering and placed it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. As the two of them went on together, Isaac spoke up and said to his father, "Father." "Yes, my son," Abraham replied. "The fire and the wood are here," Isaac said, "but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" Abraham answered, God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son. And the two of them went on together. When they reached the place God had told them about, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. Then he reached out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called out to him from heaven, "Abraham, Abraham!" "Here I am," he replied. "Do not lay a hand on the boy," he said. "Do not do anything to him. Now I know that you fear God, because you have not withheld from me your son, your only son." Abraham looked up, and there in a thicket he saw a ram caught by its horns. He went over and took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. So Abraham called that place, "The Lord will provide." And to this day it is said, "On the mountain of the Lord it will be provided." The angel of the Lord called to Abraham from heaven a second time and said, "I swear by myself, declares the Lord, and because you have done this and have not withheld your son, your only son, I will surely bless you and make your descendants as numerous as the stars in the sky and the sand on the seashore. Your descendants will take possession of the cities of their enemies, and through your offspring all nations of the earth will be blessed, because you have obeyed me." We're going to look briefly at that passage in a moment, but first the band are going to play to us that lovely chorus that says, "Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace." Thank you, band. Thank you, band. That was beautiful. Thank you. Moriah, the Mount of New Perspective. Have you ever climbed a mountain? We've heard of one family. Yeah, there's a few nods. Anybody climbed a mountain? Give me a nod if you have. Yeah, good, good, good. Here's a photo. Sorry, we seem to be bombarding you with photos. It's a very, very visual meeting this morning. There's a photo of me with a fellow climber. I can't even remember his name. That's terrible, isn't it? One of the young members of the Corps. At the top of the mountain that I ever climbed, and I was about 16 or 17 at the time, I don't know what the mountain was called, but it took several hours to get to the top. And guess what? A lot less to come back down again. And thankfully, there were no sprained ankles or any injuries. We climbed it as part of a youth camp in Argentina, where I was living at the time. And the moment of reaching that top was a moment that has stayed with me ever since. And I don't know if, having heard what Mark said, whether there's something that hooks you, an experience that you think, I want to do this again. I've never done this before, and this is really, really excited me. We were the first to reach the top of the mountain, and it was such an achievement, such a thrill. And if you look at the next slide, you could see the Andes in front of you. The view, for me, that was what struck me when I got to the top. Now, if you've been a climber or you've climbed mountains, and wonder what it was that struck you most when you got to the top. Was it the fact that you'd got there? You know, it'd been such a slog to actually get to the top. You actually was just so relieved, I've made it. Or were you already scared of having to go down again? Maybe you're at the top, but immediately you're thinking, but I've got to get back down again. Is it the pain of your leg muscles or the bruises and cuts that you picked up along the way getting up there? Or was it just the fact that you had made it when you never thought you could? Now, as we're talking about Mount Moriah, it's no Mount Everest at all. You will see on the next photo that Mount Moriah is actually only as high as Slieve Binion, which is fairly high, of course, 700-odd metres, twice the height of Cave Hill. That's just to give you an idea of how far Abraham and Isaac were climbing on that day. This mountain wasn't significant because of its height, but it was significant because of what happened on that mountain. It's the place where Abraham almost sacrifices his son. It's also significant because on that mountain, centuries later, Solomon built the Temple of Jerusalem. And you can see a black and white photo of the temple right at the top. And if you look at the next one, you can see it as a more recent photo of Jerusalem with the temple at the top, viewed from the Jewish cemetery. So it might be that this mountain Moriah is not very significant compared to other mountains, but it is significant for Abraham. And I asked myself, what could be significant about it for us today, in the year 2021, right here in Belfast? What might this experience in these few moments together teach us about God and how we relate to him as his disciples? Well, if we go back to the mountain climbers in Genesis 22, Abraham's climb was very, very different to mine. If you look at the next slide, Reuben, for Abraham, this mountain was an obstacle. God had said to him, take your son, and he specifies, your only son, Isaac. Abraham and Sarah had been barren. They had not been able to have children. And Isaac was the son of the promise, born miraculously almost, born with a promise that through him God would give Abraham descendants. And so God says, so how awkward, how strange, how incredible that God would say, take your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on the mountain. Now, we don't have time this morning to go into great detail about what this burnt offering might have meant for the people of God, but you can imagine it. Abraham is asked to take wood, to take his son, and to burn the two together until only ashes are left. Now, as I read the Bible, I can't help but think, how gruesome. Is that really what God would ask Abraham to do? How could Abraham even entertain that thought as a parent? How could God ask him to do that? What kind of a God is God to ask a father to do that? So it's very easy and very understandable to see this mountain as an obstacle, a demanding challenge that seemed unsurpassable, a bit like the mountains of Moriah in J.R. Tolkien's Lord of the Rings, the challenge to the hobbits, the challenge to those brave guardians. Mount Moriah may not be as high as Everest, but it's certainly as high as that for Abraham. The father and the son climbing up, and here's a cartoon that the children would have possibly seen something like in the next one, Reuben, in Sunday school. And even there you can see the faces of both Abraham and Isaac upset because they know, or at least Abraham knows, what is happening ahead. But regardless of his age and of what God is asking him to do, Abraham goes through. And it doesn't take long before even Isaac begins to wonder what's going on. He says, something's missing, Dad. You've got the wood and you've got the knife and you've got the fire, but where's the animal? Did he also see it as an obstacle? We know that Abraham had faith, because if you read that passage again in verse 5, you see that Abraham says to the servants, well, we've nearly got to the place, so you stay here. My son and I will go up and we will come down again. He had faith that somehow God would work it out and they would make their way back down again. And he also replies to his son, don't worry, Isaac, because God will provide a lamb for the offering. He was a man of faith, but as a parent, I cannot imagine that for Abraham, this was easy. This was an obstacle. This was a sacrifice he was struggling to give. Can you feel what he feels? Can you identify with his heart being torn in two? Can you understand why this mountain would be such an obstacle to him? Surely there would be another way. If only he could get rid of that mountain. If only, we might think when we face our own mountains, if only we could clear those mountains and have things back as they were before, or how I would want them to be. But that's how it is at Mount Moriah. And Abraham knows he cannot go any other way. He has to go through it. And so it's unmovable, it's an obstacle, but somehow he trusts that God will see him through. And so he looks up. And as he looks up, he sees the place where God has told him to go. Now, I showed you the photo of me at 16 or 17, the place where I first climbed my mountain. And up until that moment, I would have seen plenty of mountains. And maybe like you growing up here in Belfast, surrounded by mountains, you're used to looking up at them and you're used to maybe thinking of them as an obstacle. You know, if I was to climb up there, I've got to be ready. But for Abraham, this became not an obstacle, but a place of new perspective. The first time I climbed that mountain, for me, I began to not only look at the mountains, look up at the mountains, but to recognize that there's a view from the top that is new. There is a new perspective, as Psalm 121 reminded us of. At the point where Abraham reaches the place where God had told him to go and build an altar, he begins the process of going through this obstacle. He ties his son, he places him on the altar, he gets the knife out, ready to do what God has asked him to do, however crazy it feels. Surely God would ask him to do something else. Do you know, as we think about some of those things that we struggle with, some of those things that we might think are an obstacle or a mountain, God knows how real they are for us. He knew exactly how real this obstacle was for Abraham. I wonder what mountain lies before you. I wonder what mountains you were facing this past week. I wonder what God has asked you to do, maybe even a long time ago. And it's just always remained an obstacle. Is it a sacrifice? Is it something that God has asked you to lay on the altar? Has it involved another person? Or maybe something that has been unforgiven? or something that God has asked you to do that you've thought, well, that is just too much. I can't do it. And maybe this morning, like God proved to Abraham, what you think is an obstacle, I'm going to do with you, and I'm going to provide for you. Because for Abraham, when he took this final step to reach the mountain and do what God asked him to do, God gave him a new perspective, and he realized that the sacrifice was different. What God was asking him to do, he had already done by trusting him. And so God says, Abraham, Abraham, do not lay a hand on the boy. Do not do anything to him, because I know you've done the sacrifice already. You've come this far. I'm not asking you to kill your son. I asked you to trust me with him. And there's a difference. And Abraham could only understand this when he got to that point. For the first time in his life, Abraham saw that God wanted to trust him with everything. If you read Genesis up until that point, you see that Abraham has been given this amazing promise. And yes, he's got Isaac, but he had already tried it with his concubine, because just in case God doesn't provide, I'm going to have my own backup plan. And time again in Genesis, Abraham does this. He trusts God, but he has his own little plan just in case things don't quite work out. And God doesn't provide. And for the first time here, he actually gives God everything. He chooses to trust God and go through with it. And it's at that point that the obstacle becomes a new perspective. And it's the place where he realizes, actually, God provides. Abraham's test wasn't to lose what was most precious to him. It was simply to trust God with it. Look, God says, I've given you everything you need. And in fact, the writer of Genesis in verse 14 says, to this day, that place is called on the mountain of the Lord, it will be provided. To this day, wherever you face a mountain of the Lord, if you choose to go through with it, God will provide what you most need. That's why that place stands today. And I love that prayer at the end of your reflection, Mark, where someone else has said, God, I thank you. That marks the point where God has been. And Jesus reminded his disciples of this too. If Ruben could just scroll us to the words from Matthew. In Matthew 6, we read these words. Jesus said to his disciples, if you decide for God, living a life of God worship, it follows that you don't fuss about what's on the table at mealtimes or whether the clothes in your closet are in fashion. There is far more to your life than the food you put into your stomach, more to your outer appearance than the clothes you hang on your body. Look at the birds. You count more than birds. Give your entire attention to what God is doing right now, and don't get worked up about what may or may not happen tomorrow. God will deal with whatever hard things come up when the time comes. You may know that verse more familiarly as, seek God's kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Give God your attention right now. Seek God's kingdom first. Climb whatever mountain is in front of you. Don't try to go around it. Don't try to go around the other way. Just go through it and trust God. Trust that God is not mean or sadistic, or that he doesn't care about what you need. He's utterly loving, but he's also utterly committed to making this world what he intended it to be. And for that, he needed to know that Abraham was also utterly committed to trusting him. So as we allow this mountain to give us a glorious view, I ask you, what is it that God wants your attention on? What is it that God is asking you to do so that you can show, actually, God, you are first, and I trust you. Abraham and those who followed in his footsteps are inviting us to climb that mountain and to recognize that if it is the mountain of the Lord, then the Lord will provide. My help will come from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. I invite you to experience the Lord not as a God of obstacle, but as a God of new perspective and a God of provision. I'm going to sing that lovely chorus that says, all there is of me, all there is of me. Time and talents, day by day, all I bring to thee. For Abraham, that all was very costly, and it was scary and confusing, and it risked everything that God had said. But because he did it, he knew God's provision. If there is something this morning that the Lord is asking you to trust him with, I encourage you to do it. I encourage you to lay it at the altar. Nobody needs to know what that is. Only you and the Lord need to know. And if it's helpful to just come and kneel, and if you want to pray by yourself, then bring something with you. Bring your mask or bring your piece of paper, bring your keys, and we will leave you on your own to pray, just you and the Lord. But if you want someone to pray with you, then come alone and we will pray with you, that God will just help you to trust him. This is a place of prayer, like the altar that Abraham came to, and it is always open for us to find that same provision. Let's sing together, all there is of me. Thank you for the words, Reuben. You, if you need to do this morning, if you need to lay this before the Lord, then don't go away carrying the sacrifice with you. Leave it with the Lord, because he will not forsake you. He will not forsake you. We'll sing it once more. Oh, there is a Lord Jesus, this morning, we thank you that this experience, this Mount of Moriah, which must have broken Abraham's heart, became such a life-changing experience for him. And he knew you as the one who would provide. Lord, if any of us this morning are facing mountains that seem unsurpassable, and mountains that maybe have been with us for a number of years, Lord, I pray that you will help us to trust you. Lord, I pray that we will be able to trust you with the things that are most precious to us. With our families, with our children, with our parents, with our jobs, or our finances, or our homes, our health. Lord, for so many of us, life asks us to give up things, and it's difficult. And Lord, we just pray that you would help us to know you as the one who provides. May we know your peace and your grace. May we know that you can be the one who holds us high as we look to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. I invite you to stand as we sing our final song this morning. Beautiful song in our songbook that says, Jesus, be the center. Jesus, be the wind in my sails. Be the reason that I live. Jesus, in our songbooks, 373, and I think the band and the piano will help us this morning. We've got a little introduction, so I invite you to stand. If it's new to you, then enjoy it as others sing, and pick it up, and we'll sing it again. Thank you.
Thank you.
Amen. What a wonderful prayer to finish on. Lord Jesus, as we leave this place, to wherever we go during this week, meet us there. Be in the centre of our hopes and our dreams and our vision, of our lives, of our homes, of our work, of school, of all that we do. Jesus, be in the centre of all of that. Amen. Amen. God bless you and thank you.